Jaya Radha Madhava Kanjabi Hari Jaya. Jaya Radha Madhava Kanjabi Hari Jaya. Jai Gopi Janavallabha Giri Vahadhi Hayango. Jai Gopi Janavallabha Giri Vahadhi Hayango. Giri Yasoda Nandana Dhraja Janaranjanaya Yasoda Nandana Dhraja Janaranjanaya. Jamuna Tira Havana Chahiyana Tira Yamuna Tira Havana Chahi Yamuna Tira Hai Radha Madhava Kunjabi Hari Madhava Kunjabi. Hai Radha Madhava Kunjabi Hari. Hai Gopi Janavallabha Giri Vahadhi. Giri. Jai Gopi Janavallabha Giri Vahadhi. Giri Yasoda Nandana Braja Janaranjanaya Yasoda Nandana Braja Janaranjanaya Jamuna Tira Havana Chahariyamuna. Jamuna Tira Havana Chahariyamuna Jai Radha Madhava Kunjabi Hari. Radha Madhava Kunjabi. Jai Radha Madhava Kunjabi Hari. Kunjabi Hari. Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna, 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 Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Krishna, Hare Om. Hey, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Krishna. Hari Bol. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, Hare Krishna, Krishna, Nitai Gaur, Rama Rama. Jaya Pancha Tattva, Pancha Tattva, Pancha Tattva, Jaya Pancha Tattva. Pancha Tattva. Jaya Ghorani Thai, Ghorani Thai, Ghorani Thai, Jaya Ghorani Thai. Ghoranita Jaya Jaya Prabhupada 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 Jaya Prabhupada Prabhupada Jaya 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 Prabhupada Prabhupada Prabhupada, Jai Prabhupada. Gaur Premanande Hari Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai. Hare Krishna. So we'll read from Srimad Bhagavatam, Bhagavad-gita. This is the ninth chapter, the most confidential knowledge, which is considered the more intimate knowledge that Krishna reveals throughout the Gita. And this is verse 27, which is a very often quoted verse to give a very, very significant point. This is to be known to follow in Krishna consciousness. Om namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Yat karosi yaranasi, yat jahosi dadasi yat, yat tapasyasi kaunteya, tat kuruswa mar arpanam, yat karori yat asnasi, yad jahosi dadasi yad, yad tapasyasi kaunteya, tad kurushva mararpanam, yad karosi yad anasi, yad jahosi dadasi yad, yad tapasyasi kaunteya, yad kurushva mararpanam. else? Yat? Whatever. Karosi. You do. Yat? Whatever. Asnasi. You eat. Yat? Whatever. Jahosi. You offer. Dadasi. You give away. Yat? Whatever. Yat? Whatever. Tapasyasi. Austerities you perform. Kaunteya. O son of Kunti. Tat. That. Kuruswa. Do. Mat. Unto me. Arpanam. As an offering. Krishna speaking. Whatever you do, whatever you eat, whatever you offer or give away, and whatever austerities you perform, do that, O son of Kunti, as an offering to me. So Krishna is somewhat summarizing all the possible areas that we can function in. And what does he say? What is the conclusion? Do it to me. Do it as an offering to me. In other words, make me the goal of your activities. Purport. Thus, it is the duty of everyone to mold his life in such a way that he will not forget Krishna in any circumstance. Everyone has to work for maintenance of his body and soul together. And Krishna recommends herein that one should work for him. So we have to maintain the body and the soul. So therefore there are activities for both. And some activities cover, what we say, they cover for both all at once. So everyone should maintain their body and maintain their soul. Soul maintenance means to do what is favorable and to reject what is unfavorable. That's for the soul. The body, the same principles are there, but the activities are different. Everyone has to eat something to live, and therefore one should accept the remnants of foodstuffs offered to Krishna. Any civilized man has to perform some religious ritualistic ceremonies, therefore Krishna recommends, do it for me. And this is called archanam. So what does archanam mean? Worship. Okay. Everyone has a tendency to give something in charity, Krishna says, give it to me. And this means that all surplus money accumulated should be used in furthering the Krishna conscious movement. So everybody agrees? So Prabhupada used to say that my money is my money and your money is my money. So what he was saying, everything belongs to Krishna. So when he was using himself as the representative of Krishna, that's how that statement is played. In other words, whatever we have, where does it come from? So you can trace whatever you have to some source. So take it all the way back, just like where does bread come from? Where do we get bread from? Bread, yeah. From grains. Okay, so where did grains come from? From earth. Where did the earth come from? Okay, there you go. The communists would say, and this is how they use their propaganda, you go to your churches and you pray, and then people would go and say, and they would pray for bread. You pray for bread, and they would, and they come out, and then they ask the communist soldiers would say, did you get any bread? No. Okay, well here we have truckloads of bread. And so they would bring all these trucks from bread and give people as much bread as they want. So who's better, God or us? And that way, because people couldn't figure out anything, they would think, oh, communist brother, you're better. And then people would give up their religion. And that was the idea. But then the question is, where'd you get the bread from? Did you manufacture it in your factories? No. The bread comes, as you said, from the grains. The grains come from the earth, and the earth comes from God. So you can trace everything that's in existence back to its origin. So whatever we have, even Krishna Prabhupada says, you know, whatever money you've accumulated should be used for furthering the Krishna conscious process. In other words, give it back to Krishna because he is the one that provided for wealth, and therefore wealth used for furthering glorification of him is the best use of wealth. And you benefit, and so many other people will also benefit. It doesn't mean you don't take what you need. It means that whatever is extra should be used in that way. And Prabhupada changes his whole argument. Now, nowadays, people are very much inclined to the meditational process, which is not practical in this age. So what is he referring to? What is that meditational process? Yoga, well, specifically. What did Krishna teach in the sixth chapter, or talk about in the sixth chapter? Marco, what did Krishna speak in the sixth chapter? Stanga Yoga, right. And what does Asta mean? Eight means eight. Eight principles of yoga meditation. So Krishna describes it in somewhat detail, not complete, and then he says, it's not possible. It was possible for people in previous ages, but not in this age. In this age, people are not inclined to that kind of austerity, and those who attempt it hardly ever become successful. So therefore, Prabhupada's making this point. Nowadays, people are very much inclined to the meditational process, which is not practical in this age. So it means we're just not qualified in this age because of the age. But if one practices meditating on Krishna 24 hours a day by chanting the Hare Krishna mantra round his beads, he is surely the greatest meditator and the greatest yogi, as substantiated in the sixth chapter of the Bhagavad Gita. So what is that verse that Prabhupada is referring to in the sixth chapter? Who knows? Yeah, it's the last verse in the sixth chapter. Out of all yogis, he who abides in me, worship me in great and transcendental faith, is the highest of all yogis. In other words, he's the best of all. In other words, one who is a bhakti yogi, because Krishna in the sixth chapter goes through Astanga Yoga, which includes Raja Yoga, includes Hatha Yoga, then there's Karma Yoga. He talked about them in the third and fourth chapter. There's Jnana Yoga, which he'll talk about in the 13th chapter. And then, but ultimately, bhakti is the pinnacle or the highest form of all yoga, and that yoga is the yoga of devotion. So no other forms of activity. Yoga means to connect. So if you want to connect, you can connect with Krishna through karma yoga, with jnana yoga, but you get results according to that type of yoga. So from karma yoga you get some detachment, from jnana yoga you get knowledge and some detachment, but from bhakti yoga you get Krishna. Yeah. So just like you might be connected with a person that person may give you some, just like there are people who are connected to a big person. A big person may be an operator of a big corporation. So he has his workers. So they're karma yogis. They work for him. They're doing some work, they get some benefit. And then there's other people who may be his friends and they know about him. But then again, the family members who are more intimate, they have a loving relationship with that person. And that relationship is complete. Whereas working for and knowledge of is less than complete, but it has some benefit because it can lead to higher levels. But Prabhupada goes right to the source, meditation on Krishna by chanting his name. So what is it about the holy name that is the perfect meditation? Why is that given the emphasis? Well, yeah, we know that, but to explain what you mean by everything. I mean, that's general. Just what is it about the holy name that makes it the perfect meditation? Yeah, that's the whole thing. Krishna's name is Krishna. Whatever is included in Krishna is included in his holy name. Yeah, so that's the answer. Krishna's name is Krishna. It's non-different. Of course, that takes some understanding and some realization to come to that understanding, but that's the actual reality. So therefore, that's why to chant the holy names on beads, because beads help you to meditate by giving you a connection, helping to give you a connection. You associate with Krishna through sound. Okay, so people will marginalize this verse and say, well, yes, I can offer whatever I eat to him, but maybe what I do is separate, you know, because I might work in the factory or I might work in the office. And how can I, you know, offer that to Krishna? Or how can I do that for Krishna? Or if I'm giving charity to someone, how is that done for Krishna? Or if I give up something, how is that? So, but Krishna explains that because he is the foundation, the root, he's called Mula, another name for Krishna is Mula, which means root, of everything, when everything is performed in relationship to Krishna, whatever it is, because he's connected to everything. He's never outside of anything. So when you want to give away something, think about how giving away that will benefit or connect you with Krishna. In other words, how is that a service to Krishna, giving away something? Can someone give an example of giving something away that's a service to Krishna? How is giving something away? Because Krishna says, whatever you offer or give away, do it for me. So how can you give something away? How is that a service to Krishna? Mm-hmm. Yeah, you give something to his representative, but Krishna is using it in a general term. That whatever you give away, he doesn't say specifically to his representative. In other words, giving away something has some benefit in helping you become more Krishna conscious. So if you connect that activity with your devotional practice, then in other words, you'll give away something for the benefit of the person you give it to, or you'll give away something because you don't need it, either way. So make Krishna the object of that. Connect that to Krishna and make that a service. I'm doing this because it will connect me more with Krishna. I don't need this. I develop some detachment. So practicing detachment, which will help bring one closer to Krishna, at least by getting rid of things we don't need, or by benefiting someone else by giving something away, it also can be connected to Krishna in devotion. Krishna, this verse generally is, sometimes they say this is for householders, this verse. But in a broader sense, it could be applied to everyone. Because householders do a lot of these things here, where some people who live in the ashram won't perform some of these activities. But the point is the same. Do everything as an offering to me. Because the activity and the intelligence it takes to perform the activity comes from Krishna. The ingredients that make up the activity is supplied by Krishna. And the intelligence, the ingredients, and the determination to carry it out is also supplied by Krishna. As Krishna says in the Bhagavad-gita, I am the intelligence of the intelligent, or I am the ability in all living beings. So when we break everything down, everything is either Krishna personally or Krishna through his energies. So everything falls into one of two categories. Everything is Krishna or Krishna's energy. We deal a lot with Krishna's energy. And Krishna's energy, in one sense, is non-different than Krishna. So whatever, even our body doesn't belong to us. It was given to you. You got it from your mother and father, who got it from their parents, and you take it all the way back, comes back to Krishna. And the soul, you get, is actually coming from Krishna also, because you are part and parcel of Krishna. So you, the soul, belongs to Krishna, and the body you have belongs to Krishna. But, and you will see, even in day-to-day work, life, a person will use their body to work for someone, so that body belongs to the person they're working for, at least in that particular sense. And if a person is in a family, then the person, that body belongs to the activities that make up the family responsibilities. So everyone is using their body for something, and someone else is taking advantage of that. So in one sense, we're giving our bodies to everyone in different ways. So at what point do we say, well, it's my body? You can say, I have this body, but it's not mine. There's a whole verse in the Bhagavatam that explains how the body is used in the service of different elements within society and belongs to those different elements at the time it's being used. But ultimately, the point I'm making is that everything is Krishna. There's nothing about us that is us except our soul, which is also part of Krishna, so that belongs to Krishna too. So when you look at it, and you think, well, I have this, I have that, I'm this, I'm that. This is all just taking possession of something that's been given to you. That's all. Everything we have is given to us. So we don't own anything. But there's an element of our existence that's unique, and that is the propensity to love. So when we give our love to Krishna, then everything we have and everything we are becomes fully satisfied. So then everything is perfect in our relationship with Krishna. But when we don't have that relationship, or when the relationship is weak, then we try to take shelter of the things that Krishna gives us to find happiness in those things, which are not ours in the first place, anyway. And that's material life. That's why people are never satisfied, because they're using something that doesn't belong to them to try to benefit from those things. They're not benefiting, but they're trying. It's like a whole bunch of dacoits. They go and they rob a bank, and they steal the money, and they get into the car, and they get away. And then when they get to their hideout, They all say, okay, now let's divide it honestly. What's the term honest mean in this case? How can you steal something and then say, talk about dividing it honestly? No, in the same way, this is the material life. People have stolen things from God and they think it's yours and they want to divide it honestly. This is your lot. This is for you and this is for me. And that's material life. So Krishna is trying to help us get over that by saying, you know, whatever you have, you may be very wealthy, but understand, you know, whatever you use your wealth for, do it as a service for me. And that way, Krishna doesn't need, because he's complete in himself, he's called Atmarama, that means he's self-satisfied. He doesn't need anything we give him. But we need to give, because otherwise, if we don't give, then we have the tendency to try to enjoy that separately. And that entangles us in a whole network of difficulties, which ends up in frustration. Mm-hmm. So a person that becomes happy when they realize they have nothing, but at the same time they have a chance to have everything by having Krishna. And of course, we always say, you know, you come into this world with nothing and you leave in the same way. There was one culture, I think it's still active, it's called the Egyptian culture. When the great pharaohs and kings of the Egyptian culture, they would be fabulously wealthy with so much gold and riches. And so they would also believe in the next life, they believed in reincarnation. So when they would die, they would have all the riches buried with them. So when they came back in the next life, they could start where they left off. And yeah, that was their culture, to bury everybody with all the stuff that they had accumulated in the last life. But that doesn't work, because you don't know where you're going. That body will stay there and turn into something else, and you may not even wind up on the same planet, what to speak about getting the riches, you know. So yeah, so people have all ideas how to somehow steal Krishna's property, life after life. But, and Krishna knows that, you know, although it belongs to him, he's not interested in enjoying it, he's interested in giving it to us so we use it for our service, for his service. Just like it's mentioned in the Shastras that if you want to worship the Ganges, Mother Ganges, you go down to the banks of the Ganges, you pick up a handful of water, and then you offer prayer. While you're offering the prayer, you pour the water back into the Ganges. So you're making a prayer, and you're pouring the Ganges water back into the Ganges as an offering to the Ganges. So you got the water from the Ganges and you give it back to the Ganges. So what's the difference? The prayer. That's all. So that's our position, that our relationship with God is giving back everything that he gave to us, but in the mood of devotion. That's all. When we can understand that, then we can be detached. We can have a lot or we can have very little. We're happy. Because it's not by how much you have or don't have, it's by how much you use what Krishna gives you to serve Krishna, that's all. He gives you your intelligence, use that. He gives you time, use that. He gives you wealth, use that. He gives you many things. All have an opportunity to be used. Of course, you can't use sinful activities because sinful activities really have no substance anyway. There's nothing there except just a wrong mentality. That can't be offered. So this verse is complete because it allows us to be free. Everything belongs to you. I belong to you. And the more we connect with Krishna by using whatever Krishna gives us, we're happy. And if we can benefit others by giving them something that Krishna gives to us, that's also service to Krishna. That's also so helping others become Krishna consciousness by giving them something that Krishna gave us is actually the best service to Krishna. Life is simple in Krishna consciousness. In the material world, they're always trying to get, keep, and use. And they're always afraid someone is going to steal it, or they're going to lose it, or they're not going to enjoy it. People are in anxiety. They try for something, they don't get it, they're unhappy. They try for something, they get it, doesn't make them happy. They try for something, they get it, makes them happy for a little while, and then it goes. So which one do you want? You can choose between any one of the three. So whatever Krishna gives us, and he will, he likes to give to his devotees, just use it for his service, take what you need to live nicely, happily, and worship Krishna by using his property for his service. That's all. And that's Krishna consciousness. It's easy. But because we're conditioned to think in another way, that we make, well, this is me, and there's Krishna. So I got my, I have to have my space, spaced out, So we see that we make a distinction between our life and Krishna. But if we mold our life in connection to Krishna, then we'll see that we're never separated from Krishna. We sleep so we can take care of the body and rest it, so we can have the energy to serve the Lord like that. We eat to nourish the body so we can also have the nourishment and the happiness to serve Krishna. So even bodily care is done as a service to Krishna. Okay, so this verse is one of the more quoted verses by Srila Prabhupada and is considered a verse that those who live in household life, specifically this verse is meant for them. Because when Lord Chaitanya was speaking to Sri Ramananda Roy in Kavur, and then the Lord asked him, well, what is the perfection of life? And Ramananda Roy said, Aradhanam Sarveshan Vishnu Arnapadam. He talked about the Vanashram system. And then Lord Chaitanya said, well, that's nice, but tell me more. And then he quoted this verse, Yat Kurosi Yaranasiyas. And Lord Chaitanya said, that's also nice, but tell me more. And then he quoted Sarva Dharma Pradikshajam Mamekam. The Lord said, that's also nice, but tell me more. Finally, he was going to higher and higher spiritual principles until he came to the love of Krishna and the love of the gopis in Krishna and Vrindavan. So on all different levels, there's different levels of surrender. This is not complete surrender. But it gets us moving in the right direction. It gets us. This is complete detachment. This is complete detachment. But bhakti is more than detachment, it's love. So as we were explaining, there are people who are detached, but they don't have love or don't work on developing love. They think detachment is a form of happiness. And there's a lot like that. And that was the hippie movement back in the early 60s, 70s, where people were just giving up, You know, people who were born in very rich families, they weren't taking any wealth from their parents. They were living on the streets and just, you know, being as free from the worldly activities as possible, although they had so many opportunities. And they considered that, you know, like the way of life. They were rejecting everything material. And they were creating another type of materialism, which was kind of like we call it bohemianism, living freely, living whatever way you want. But it was just another form of sense gratification. So there are people who practice detachment for the sake of detachment, and they also develop some knowledge because of that detachment. But then again, because they don't come to the platform of love, they remain somewhat unfulfilled. And sometimes they're also hard-hearted too. They think detachment, oh, you're so attached. Just like on a codicil. You know, codicil says you should not eat grains and beans. And there's people who take a codicil on different levels. There's five ways you can honor a codicil. It's complete fast, nothing, no water. That's called nirjal. When that is actually the ekadasi. But Prabhupada didn't give us that standard. That's how the yogis perform ekadasi. They don't take anything for 24 hours and they just do their prayers, meditations. And then there's the next one down is just water. And then the next one down is a little fruit and milk, and then the next one down is food that is not cooked, and then the last one is no grains and no beans. So Prabhupada gave us the easiest way. So you might be fasting on ekadasi and not taking anything, and someone else is eating some foods, and you're thinking, wow, boy, that person is really a sense enjoyer on ekadasi. But what's happening is your false ego is having a feast. So you're really dancing in your mind, and that mentality is better. You eat something than have that mentality. So that's just an example of how people who get into false types of renunciation and think that that is actually the principle. And renunciation leads to bhakti, but material renunciation doesn't. It just leads to hard-heartedness and intolerance of others. Yeah. And you can go, and you can see yogis, they're very detached. But as Lord Brahma says, aruna krishchena padam padam padantiyada Nadritya Usmai Ahangrayaha, because they don't have bhakti, because they don't show love for Krishna, Padantiyada, they fall down again into the material world. And you see, the yogis, gyanis, and mayavadis, they perform a lot of austerities, study the Vedas, do various types of mantra chanting, pujas and stuff. But then after some time, they go back and open hospitals or do some kind of welfare work. They start functioning in a mode of goodness again. Because they can't stay on that platform, because you could only stay on that platform because that platform is not a steady platform. It's simply a step towards a higher platform. If you don't go to the higher platform, which is bhakti, as Krishna explains, then you fall down to the lower platforms and take up material activities again. So devotees don't have to worry. They go right to the spiritual platform by using everything in the service to the Lord for the pleasure of the Lord. Mm-hmm. You can use things in the service of the Lord, but not for the pleasure of the Lord. But that's not complete bhakti. Only when you try to please Krishna, then that is bhakti. So the consciousness of wanting to please Krishna has to be part of the activity. Otherwise, it's not It has elements of bhakti, but it's not complete bhakti. Complete bhakti is when we do something to please the Lord, and the Lord is pleased by the activity. And the Lord tells us how to please Him. Just do everything as an offering to me with devotion. As He mentions in the previous verse, yadanasi. You know, I mean, what is it? Patram pushu. Offer me so many things that are so insignificant with love. So love is the difference between success and karma. So how do we love Krishna? Well, Krishna is lovable, but you have to hear about Him. You have to hear about Him more and more and more, and that way your love will increase. Because it's natural to love Krishna, but it only comes when we awaken that love through hearing about Him. So hearing about Krishna more and more attracts us to Krishna more, and then the attraction turns into love. First it turns into affection, and then it turns into love. So the process is to hear about Krishna, also speak about Krishna, and try to remember Krishna as much as possible. So there's two parts to that. There is Harinam and Krishna Katha. And both are required, not just Harinam, but Krishna Katha also. Krishna's pastimes, Krishna's qualities, like that. Okay, so this verse is not the highest, but it leads to a higher platform. Okay, we stop there and see if there's any comments, questions.
Krishna. So we hear a few terms, bhakti, devotion, and love.
Pretty much they're all the same.
Yes, I know.
But devotion, we should say devotional service.
Yeah.
Prabhupada never liked the word devotion without the word service connected to it, because then that makes devotion complete. There is devotion without service, but it has a tendency to fall short. Only when we do something for Krishna with devotion is that bhakti.
And we say love for Krishna, and in connection with this, how we express love to Krishna through service to devotees.
Because Krishna says, if you want to serve me, serve my devotees. Krishna has given us the direction. And he says, if one who says he's my devotee is not my devotee. One who says he's a devotee of my devotee is my devotee. And Prabhupada emphasizes that by one should try to serve the devotees of the Lord as the way to serve Krishna. Because when the devotees are pleased, and how to serve the devotees means to do something that will help them in their Krishna consciousness. Or even if you give them something material, which is they could use in their service to Krishna consciousness, that's also devotional service too. Say you need money, and I have it, and you need it for something, and that will help you in your Krishna consciousness. And if I can, and if I give you that money, and it helps you to make advancement in your Krishna consciousness, then that's service. Or if I have some time, or something like that. So you can serve in different ways. So the service to the devotees is something you have to think about. You have to figure out how to do it. There's some people think, well, I'll serve the devotees when I get a chance. No, that's not enough. You have to actually plan how to serve the devotees. then your service will develop, because then it becomes, you get ideas and you also get facility. Facility means you get the chance to serve the devotees when you plan on how to do it. Think about how to serve the devotees. And there's people who do that all the time. They just think of different ways to serve the devotees. And then they stay engaged nicely in service. Just like there's one god sister of mine. She's a pujari. She's quite elderly. She's my age. And when she comes off the altar, she brings some of the maha with her and keeps it. And then she'll meet some devotee during the day and she'll give them a little maha. Just out of her own natural love, she'll give some maha to someone. And or she'll carry some books, small little books, and meet someone, she'll give a book out. Or sometimes she gives gifts. In other words, she thinks of different ways how to serve the devotees. And then she does her regular service also. So she doesn't have to do all this extra, but that's her nature. She likes to do it. I can tell you a nice story about her. She was doing book distribution one time, and she met some man in the street, and he became really attracted to her, and he asked her to marry him. He asked her if she would marry him. And she didn't know what to do. And so she didn't say yes and didn't say no. She didn't say anything. And then after some time, she had a dream. And Prabhupada appeared in the dream and said, "You should marry him." And so she did. And he was just a common guy on the street. And then when she married him, he became a devotee. And then after so many years, he died. I remember I was practically in that same area at that time when he left his body. So she saved this one soul by connecting that soul with her, because she was such a good devotee, you know. In one sense, although she became his wife, he became her disciple. He was really, in one sense, her disciple. She brought him to Krishna consciousness and she helped him to, you know, progress. Jai Sri Sri Panchatattva Ki Jai. Okay. Does that help? Yeah. Okay, Hare Krishna. Yeah, anything else? Yes.
Thank you. Could I please ask if we have desire to do like something big for Krishna, is that the part of our conditioned nature? And could I please ask how to remain humble in all single circumstances?
Well, you want to do something big for Krishna. That's nice. But you should understand, well, you should get permission from Krishna's representative. And also understand, you can also, when you get permission, you discuss what you want to do and see if it's something that will help you. Because a lot of times we may be doing something that is not beneficial for us. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, to want to do something big for Krishna is very good. But then again, blessings and permission both make it successful. Mm-hmm. But if you act on your own, then you don't know whether it's good for Krishna or not. Because Krishna doesn't need anything, but he appreciates our desire to serve him like that. Make sense?
Thank you.
Okay, thank you for the question. Yeah. There was one devotee, he's still there. He always thought big, how to do big for Krishna. He never wanted to do anything small. But then he decided to do one big thing, which wasn't so approved by Prabhupada. And he did it, and he got some success, but still, because it wasn't approved by Prabhupada, it wasn't seen as something great. He actually risked his life to do it, and almost died, but... So, yeah. So we should make sure we get the blessings like that. Okay, is there anything else? I don't think so. Okay, Srila Prabhupada ki jai, Srimad Bhagavad Gita ki jai.
Jai.